Welcome, everyone. Can everyone hear me? Okay. Thanks so much for coming out on our rainy evening. I think we probably could all use some meditation and mindfulness tonight after driving in the rain and dealing with this weather in May. So we're really, really excited to have this mindfulness and meditation forum this evening, and excited to have Jacob here with us. When we were talking about what types of forums we wanted to do this spring, we know how important meditation and mindfulness is when you're recovering from breast cancer. We talk to our clients a lot about it, and it's something that people are always asking for. So we thought that this would be a good forum to have and to be able to have in our library also. We're videoing, so you can go back and check everything tomorrow, too, to follow along. So I reached out to the university and asked them who they recommended, because we're always trying to find good partnerships. And I got an email back in 1 second saying, absolutely Jacob Cooper. So we're very excited to hear from him this evening. He's going to lead us in some mindfulness and meditation exercises. And I'll let him do a little more introduction for himself.
Okay. Alrighty. Thank you. Well, welcome everyone here tonight. I know the weather conditions weren't the most ideal, but we're here and we're going to make it ideal. We're going to make it real.
Keep talking.
You got it. You know, a little bit about me. I work as a full-time social worker, and I work as a full-time therapist, but I'm also a certified hypnotherapist and Reiki master. And like you were discussing, I run a lot of groups and projects and things here at Adelphi, amongst other colleges. And I lecture at libraries and other organizations. But tonight, we're here to really, I'm here to really talk a little bit about mindfulness. And towards the end, we're going to be giving a couple of techniques to allow you to be more mindful. Now, by a show of hands, how many of you have been to a mindfulness lecture or practice any kind of meditation? Okay, so we've got a good group. So we have, I think in the Zen tradition, we talk about the beginner's mind and expert mind. So we have a lot of people who are really seasoned. That's great. Zen practice has been around for around 3,000 years, and mindfulness is really taking hold right now. It's really, you go into any supermarket, and it's right there, right in front of you. And I think that's wonderful, but it's ever more needed today. It's interesting, I think, with the shifting society, in which computers have taken over and everyone's rushing around, I really think that that's reasons why people, why people have turned towards meditation and mindfulness, really trying to work on, channeling and calming down what we call the monkey mind, or the very fast-paced, quick monkey mind. So that's what we're here today. Mindfulness to me is understood. Everyone has a different kind of take on it and what it kind of means, but to me, I look at the inverse of mindfulness and I say what mindlessness is. And to me, that means that you're fixated on one particular thing in life. And mindfulness allows people to be fully objective, fully aware, and let go of judgment. Just almost, take a step back. My journey in mindfulness began a long time ago, but when I was around 16 years old, I had a Passover Seder. And there was a man at my table who I didn't know, who had a Los Angeles Lakers championship ring on. And I asked him, where'd you get that from? And he told me that he was a sports psychologist for the Los Angeles Lakers, and as well as the Chicago Bulls. His name is George Mumford, and that got me psyched. And I read a little bit about George, and he was very, he was behind the coach at the time, Phil Jackson, who was able to really, prior to Phil Jackson, if anyone knows about sports, Michael Jordan was on the team, and he wasn't really able to win. The Detroit Pistons would stop him every year. Once Phil came in town, he was able to tame down Michael's ego and really allow Michael to be a part of a greater whole in the team. And that's what kind of mindfulness is about. It's almost taking yourself out in a way and getting into that altruistic state, getting outside of something greater than whatever you are. And that's where real peace happens. So it's a connection to yourself. And through that connection, you're able to really feel a flow and really be attuned to those around you. But a lot of mindfulness work is based off of, very simply, the stimulus-response dynamic, where you have life stimuli, such as illness or situations in a job and stuff like that, and that happens in life. Mindfulness is a great trainer for people to just pause, take a step back, and just process and evaluate, and not necessarily analyze, but just experience. And I think that's great. Mindfulness could be, done in meditation, which we'll do, but the goal of mindfulness is to be kind of like a mindful being, where you're aware, you're calm and collected, and you take a step back in life, and you accept the things that kind of happen to you versus just reacting to everything that comes to you and not really having that pause or that gap between life's events and how we handle them. I look at mindfulness kind of how it started with this whole computer system that we have that just makes us race at a million miles an hour. So to me, mindfulness meditation allows us to almost clear our hard drive in our database and allows us to really be clear and clean and everything like that. So, it's very hard to be successful if we're constantly just taking this canvas and every day we just constantly draw based off of repeated patterns. What mindfulness does is allows us to take a step back, clear it, and allows us to just, draw our own experience for every new day. And that creates, a life that allows change to happen because it comes from a clear and open point versus, habitual processing or thinking, which is makes change very hard, because we're stuck in the past. Mindfulness to me is successful because, as human beings, we're either in two places many times, or three. We're either in the past, which is sadness and thinking about events that happened, or maybe in the future, which is the uncertainty. We have anxiety. Mindfulness allows us to be present, which, we all have canvases in front of us, and we're able to draw upon what we want to see, what we want to feel. And that's, where the work comes from. But to me, the greatest aspect of mindfulness is empowerment. I think that so much of life we kind of put on other people and ask other people to kind of assist with and help with. And what mindfulness is good is it gives us the power back. It kind of tells us that, no matter what happens in life, we have our emotions, we have ourself, and we always have the ability to look at life in many different angles. I always give the analogy of what's, known as psychology as cognitive reframing. One person could see as a butterfly, one person could see as a caterpillar, the next person could see as a butterfly. So mindfulness really allows us to look at our own habitual thought processes, how we, handle, life stressors and situations, taking a step back, putting the pause button on and saying, okay, now that I've seen and experienced it, how could I redirect it? How could it be more in alignment with who I want to be and how I want to be within my life? And that allows change, that allows evolution, and that allows growth, which we're all here to do. If you look at kids, they're always walking around and smiling and having a good time. And as we get older, that's when all the mental health, situations happen. And I understand trauma plays a role in that. But really, mindfulness almost takes that childlike energy where, you don't base your own emotions off of what happened to you or things like that. You're in a natural state of joy and happiness. The analytical framework isn't as much there, and you're more just experiencing. Mindfulness just allows people to just experience and accept where they are. It doesn't necessarily have to be happiness, but through that sadness, that's awareness right then and there. It's really being attuned and aware to your own self. And, if any of you are into guitar or music, if you look at some of the greatest musicians out there, they're all obsessed with their guitars and constantly tuning it and working on it and stuff like that. But when it comes to ourselves, we forgot a little bit about that. So if you could do that to an instrument, what about our bodies? What about our psyches? What about ourselves? So mindfulness is essentially just tuning in and clearing and just recognizing where we are and clearing so we could have a proper vision of how we want to go about our lives. My work comes from, kind of altering brainwaves. I think we have four major brainwaves. And normally, we're usually on the first one, which is processing and analyzing and stuff like that. So meditation really allows you to get into the alpha states, which is ideal for meditation. I almost look at it like, you know, if you look at an ocean, we're constantly just, most of us, especially if we're in Long Island, New York, we're on the very surface of it, and we're going, you know, all around. But, you know, mindfulness meditation allows people to go towards a lower bottom end of the ocean and just kind of look up at our sea and stuff like that, and, you know, gets into that state of calm where it could really process and be successful at. And, you know, that's what we're trying to do within this meditation today, is really to get out of, you know, the first brainwave and get into the second and third. You don't want to get into the fourth, the delta brainwaves, because then you'd be asleep. But, you know, you want optimal brainwave functioning. You know, there's many different teachers out there for mindfulness, and everyone has a different philosophy and taking it. But my work comes from the analogy of the snow globe. Have everyone seen a snow globe, correct? You know, Christmas time, stuff like that. So for me, that's where I work from, you know, because I understand brain waves, being a hypnotherapist, and I understand how that works. You know, plenty of people, and I've been to classes, they just kind of sit us down in a Zen position, and they just say, focus on the wall and just look at that. And I go, how am I going to do that? You know, my brain's over here, and you're asking me to be over here. You're not meeting me where I'm at, right? So mindfulness, the way that I kind of work mindfulness meditations is, you almost have to shake things up to slow things down, just like the snow globe. So a little bit of this is kind of moving a little bit. And if anyone has any physical discomforts or anything of that nature, please let me know. And my request is that you just do anything that you're comfortable with. Don't push yourself over, you know, past your limits. So there's going to be a little bit of movement. And then once the brainwaves kind of slow down, you know, that's when we get a little bit quieter, a little bit simplified, and stuff like that. So anyone have any questions or thoughts or about any of the subject matter that I, you know, just relayed or stuff like that? I can't imagine there's no questions. None? Okay.
Maybe they might have more after we do some practice.
Yeah.
Maybe? Okay.
Yeah. I think that makes sense. Once, you know, I think people get more comfortable too, so they could raise their hands.
Yeah.
Ask those questions, because your question may be someone else's question. So questions are always encouraged. So, you know, what I usually like to begin with is something called a Tibetan, I use Tibetan bells, which, you know, sound has a very healing aspect. If you listen to, you know, James Taylor or Carole King or, you know, any of these, you know, good artists, they definitely have an effect on the brain. So with my work, I really implement a lot of what's called sound, sound waves, which really allow you, you know, can help you to really, you know, relax and just take in, you know, the sounds of the room. It's no different than music. It's just, you know, kind of channeled differently, but it may, you know, help, you know, the brainwave to get into that second alpha state. You know, I'm just going to ask you in a second or two if you're comfortable with just, you know, try to sit in an open stance. There's so many different schools of thought, and some people say to sit in a yoga pretzel and this and that, but I just say, you know, mindfulness is having a combination of intention, where you're trying to be aware of yourself and your breath and what's going on physiologically in your body, and also relaxation, where you're trying to relax. So it's not what's called a transcendental meditation, where you're just here to drift or go away. You really are supposed to try to be within your bodies. And, you know, with groups, a lot of people will look around them and see, okay, this person looks a little bit more Zen than I am. They must be doing it differently. Let me ask you something. If you were dancing on a dance floor, and if you were with your spouse, would you look at someone else dancing? Probably not. Your spouse would be pretty upset, right? So it's the same thing with ourselves, right? In order for us to be intimate, you know, with ourselves and stuff like that, we need to give ourselves attention. So it's not about what's out there within the room. It's all about what's going on within our own bodies, within our own breaths, and that creates, you know, a great rhythm and tapestry to allow us to formulate a greater connection to who we are. And, you know, as I mentioned before, many of us are existing here, but to really get to who you are, you have to kind of go a little bit deeper and slow down, and that creates a more objective viewpoint of who you are, which is kind of the goal of mindfulness and stuff like that. So if everyone's ready, just, you know, give me the thumbs up and we'll begin, okay? All right, good, good. I just have to take a sip of water, I'm sorry. Be right there. So, you know, just to give you guys a couple of examples of what I'm going to be doing, you know, within, you know, my mindfulness, you know, class, I'm going to be providing a couple different techniques that hopefully you guys may take in the session, and if it works, if something fits, then that's good. Usually I like to provide a couple different techniques because everyone's wired differently, and everyone, for some people, the movement works better, other people, you know, the sound may work better, whatever it is. The goal of mindfulness is to make it yours, make it your own practice. So that's the goal. But, you know, essentially what I'm going to be doing, you know, is, you know, the sound noise that I'm going to make, you know, using the Tibetan bells. We're going to be doing a bit of other things such as Qigong, which you're going to be connecting to an energy ball. We're going to be doing a little bit of, you know, focusing on your own, you know, bodies and connecting to it. And, you know, having almost like kind of like a biofeedback type, you know, relationship and understanding where you're holding stress, where your patterns are. And from that awareness, you could shift and change. So, you know, some people say stress is created in your thoughts and this and that. But I am a firm believer that stress is within the body. That's physiological. So a lot of our work is going to be tuning into different parts of the body and seeing where we're holding stress and scanning it and then, you know, letting it go. And, you know, a little bit of shakiness, as I said before, where we're going to adjust some, you know, some of our brain waves and stuff like that. So my request is just do what you're comfortable in doing and don't focus on another partner because, you know, we want to be intimate with ourselves, right? So we don't want to cheat. So if everyone could just, you know, slowly just unwind and take in the energy of the room, and you could close your eyes and just, that's it, just take a deep breath in and deep breath out and just connecting to your chair and yourselves. And breath, and we're here and we're safe and we're in this room and, you know, we're just with ourselves right now, just connecting to that. You feel your lower back in the chair. You may feel your shoulders. Some parts of you may be aware to different aspects of your being that you weren't tuned to before. So just connect and be more mindful. Connect to a lot more than you didn't before. This is just a new experience. This is allowing yourself to be fuller, be more whole, and more connected to who you really are. That's it. And slowly just take a deep breath in, and a lot of this is deep diaphragmic breathing, so feeling your rib cage just going up and going down with every breath, that's it. And exhale through your mouth. So just taking in new and whole and fresh energy within the room and just letting it out through your mouth. That's it. Very good. And on the count of three, I'm just going to make a bit of a high-pitched sound, and you're just going to just take it in and allow yourself to just experience it without necessarily judging, but just experience. You know, we're here to just experience. Not to judge, not to analyze, taking away a lot of our habitual processes and allowing ourselves to be in this new moment and this new body and our new self. So thank you. And just slowly just take this breath in. That's it. And with the sound, just take it in. That's it. Just take it in, breathe in. And I'm going to be doing this three times. Just breathe in. That's it. That's it. Breathe in. And out. Very good. Last time. Breathe in. And exhale. Very good. Very good. And whenever you're ready, slowly, you could open up your eyes. Connect. That's it. Feeling the body a little bit looser, a little bit more fluid, a little bit more flexible, and more connected. That's it. Okay. Now, when you were connecting to your body, did anyone feel any kind of tension or any sensations, anything like that? No? As we go forward, you know, this is a practice, so it may take a couple of tries, but eventually you should be able to feel something. Okay. So what I'm just going to ask is essentially what you're going to do is just connect, just focus on your palms, okay? And this may help to, you know, get a better idea of yourself and, you know, to just scan your own body. So you're just going to just take a deep breath in and just breathe in. And at the top, you hold it, and then you just breathe out and bring it down. Very good. So just so you could close your eyes while doing this, and just connect. Breathe in. And exhale, breathe out. Very good. Do this three more times. Just connect to your palms. And notice what you feel, what you experience as you're doing this. And just as you exhale, bring it down. So much of stress is from the neck up, and what we're trying to do is bringing in a lot of the breath down towards our bodies. That's it. And breathe out. Very good. 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 Now slowly, you could just take your shoulders and just shake them up and down, just like that. Yep. Up and down, up and down, up and down. Very good. And you could gently just shake your head side to side and just breathing in and breathing out, closing your eyes at your own pace, very gently, very slowly. Allowing yourself to connect and to just relax and just letting it go. Another 15 more seconds of just gently shaking, much like the snow globe that I spoke about. Just gently shaking and allowing yourself to just let go. Allowing your brain to just relax. The brain is a muscle. Just as it holds tension, it can definitely let it go. And through movement, we could shift and change. That's it. And slowly stop. Take a pause. In and exhale, breathe out. Very good. Breathe in and exhale, breathe out. That's it. And slowly, I'm just going to take your palms and you can rub them very fast, okay? Connect to body heat. Yeah. We have a lot of euphemisms within the English language that says that someone may have a hot head, right? Where do you think that comes from? That actually comes from overprocessed. Or you say someone has a cool head, that means that they're very relaxed. So really what you're trying to do is getting the fire kind of downwards and feeling cool-headed, right? So slowly you're just going to create a warmth and sensation, and you could focus by just putting your hand at the top of your head and just simply just connecting to that, trying to create that cool head and bringing, you know, a lot of the overprocessed thoughts down. Just close your eyes, breathing in. And exhale out, holding your head very gently, just allowing yourself to connect to your body, closing your eyes. You may have many thoughts, many ideas, many visions. That's okay. This is just not forming attachments to what you may experience, but just allowing it to just letting it go, and just be here now, be within this space, in this room, within your bodies. It's very hard to be successful if you have one foot in one room, the other foot in the other. We're just here to be within our bodies. That's all we're asked to do, right? This is our call. Very good. Just breathing in. And exhale, breathe out. Very good. Just connecting. Breathe in. And exhale, breathe out. Very good. Slowly, you're going to take your right hand and just put it right behind your head and your left hand stay on top. You can put it right by your neck. That's it. Just breathing in and breathing out. Very good. Closing your eyes and just allowing yourself to go deeper into your body and to the space with a focus on intention and relaxation. That's it. Breathing in, breathing out. Very good. Breathe in and exhale, breathe out. You may hear sounds, you may hear noise. This may feel different. That's okay. Just accept, just be, just experience. Taking the thoughts and just letting them go like passing waves within an ocean. That's it. And slowly, you're just going to take your hands, and you could put it, one hand on your heart, the other hand you could put right in the middle, over here, okay? Just allow yourself to connect to the space, okay? And just closing your eyes, breathing in, breathing out. And aspect of mindful meditation is to be more loving and more accepting, and a lot of that means towards ourselves. So connecting to this area may allow you to feel that love, that acceptance, and that connection to who you really are. Just breathing it in, allowing your chest to go up and down with every breath, and breathe it out through love, through connection. We could accept what comes and embrace who we really are, connect to a greater aspect of ourselves that's more whole, more clear, more objective. That's it. Very good. And slowly keeping that connection, you're going to just simply just place your hands in your lower diaphragm by right around your ribcage. And just simply continuing the pattern of closing your eyes and just feeling and connecting to your body. That's it. Just breathing in. Breathing out, that's it. Clear your mouth, that's good. Just allow yourself to just be in the space. Very good. Creating almost like a balloon with your stomach. Through every inhalation, it expands, and every exhalation, it just contracts. Very good. Good. Feeling your diaphragm rise and fall with every breath and every exhalation through your mouth. So breathing in through your nose. Breathing out through your mouth. And as you breathe out through your mouth, just envision your breath going towards the ground. Trying to allow your breath to be more towards the ground. That's it. Very good. Very good. Okay. Now slowly, you're going to put your hands right by your navel, your this area, okay? And just connect. Slowly just breathing in. Breathing out, very good. Good. Slowly just three more breaths. One, two, rising and falling with every breath, going deeper and deeper into your bodies. That's it. Very good. Okay. Now, slowly, you're just going to just take your hands. You can just drop them on right by your knees if that's comfortable. And just for 2 minutes, you could put your head kind of downwards. And just breathe in, breathe out while looking almost downwards, okay? Keep your eyes closed and just allowing yourself to just breathe in, breathe out. That's it. Doing great. Chest rising. Good. Three more breaths. Deep breath in. Big breath in. And exhale. Okay. Breathe in. And exhale. That's it. Good. Now that we're connected to ourselves, to our body, we could just open up our eyes and just continue that connection towards within. Very good. Slowly, what you're going to do is just rub your hands together very fast, creating that same heat. Very good. And you could simply just clap 10 times. Rub again. Very good. What you're going to do is just sweep your forehead, just sweep it, breathing in, breathing out, and you could even smile while you're doing this. Smiling really allows us to chain our brain chemistry and allows us to open. It's very enlightening to do. There's actually a club in India that meets every day. It's called the Laughing Club of India. And some people have almost nothing, but they meet on a regular basis and they just laugh hysterically. And we have conditions that tell us that there's reasons to be happy, but changing our emotions and changing our behaviors, we recognize through mindfulness that we don't necessarily need an excuse to be happy. We can connect to that inner joy. And we can train our minds and our bodies to experience that. Okay? Now slowly, everyone just rub your hands one last time. Very good. And you're just going to close your eyes and just connect to the feeling between your hands. And this really allows you to connect to a lot of greater aspects outside of yourself. So, as we said, the goal is altruism, so connection. So this allows you to formulate a greater connection toward yourself and the energy around you. So what you do is just close your eyes, but what you're going to do is just slowly, you're just going to be moving your hands back and forth, and just envisioning your hands are almost glued together in a way. So by pulling them away, you're stripping away some of that glue, but this is very, glued. So just try to, connect to the center point of your palms and just feel that going back and forth. That's it. Back and forth, and closing your eyes and just breathing in and breathing out and focus on what you feel. This is about feeling and experiencing versus analyzing. That's it. This is a great tool to allow your brain to just slow down and feel, because so much of our dissatisfaction comes from analyzing and processing, but not connecting to our emotions and our abilities to feel and change. Through connection, we could really change our emotional processing. So just connect, that's it. Just two more times, going back and forth, just connecting to that tube that connects the palms together, that's it. And slowly, what you're going to do is put your arms, your palms even, okay? With that same feeling, you're just going to simply just rise one palm up and the other palm down. That's it. That's it. And then as you go towards the bottom, you just switch up and go down. That's it. Go towards the top, you switch. That's it. And up and down. Do this a couple times. Very good. Breathing in, breathing out, and just focusing on what you feel. That's it. Good job. Three more times. Very good. Good. Breathing in, breathing out. Good. I know we all like to dance on Friday nights or sometimes Saturday nights or watch some dancing music. So what we're going to do now is a dance within ourselves and our own feelings. So just simply just use your own creativity and use your own right brains. And this is about analyzing or looking weird or feeling weird. This is just about experiencing yourselves and formulating that intimacy between you and yourself. That's, and this creates a stronger bond. So just closing your eyes and just formulating a kind of dance or a movement and flow. So much of anxiety is just stuck in, a place. And when we feel flow, we're able to really let go. And if you look at a forest or nature, the rivers flow and there's movement and there's a purpose, but with our own analytical selves, we get in the way of the flow of our own rivers and the rhythm of our own trees and forests. So this allows us to really feel our own flow and just experience our own nature without necessarily having to go to a place. Yeah, just feeling your own flow, that's it. Good. Being in harmony with who you are. Being creative. You can make circles with your palms, wherever that might be. Just one or two moments of just feeling and experiencing. Getting rid of all those logs that get in the way of flow. That's it. And that's it. And once you feel kind of connected, you just simply just take your palms in that same way. Just breathe in. Up, 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 up. That same feeling. And just close your eyes and just wash. Breathe out. Connecting to your own rhythm. That's it. One more time. Breathe in. And exhale, breathe out. Very good. Okay. That same thing, just rub your palms together. Rub, 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 rub. Okay. Very fast, very good. Okay, wonderful. And just simply just take your palms and you can just put them on your face. Breathing in and breathing out. And you could even smile to yourself. Smiling changes ourselves and our brain. Just smile to yourself and say to yourself, I love you. Sending positive messages. How many times do we get the chance to do this? Just connecting to yourselves, connecting to the love, connecting to your face. That's it. And slowly, when you're ready, you can simply just rub and just move away a lot of stress or tension within your face and just gently massage your temples. That's it. Very good. 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 So you open up your eyes. Very good. Be more mindful, more relaxed. Very good. Okay. So, now is everyone present? Everyone's in the room? Everyone's in our bodies? Okay. We're going to be doing a couple different mindful techniques, but how was that for you? Have you ever tried any of this before? Was it kind of different? Kind of different, right? Yeah. Anyone experience anything or feel anything or at least feel more connected to your body or yourself? Yeah? Does anyone feel like sharing or discussing with the group? Anyone? No? Yes?
I felt tired.
You felt tired?
Like I could be on.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. That's common. A lot of times, you know, we're kind of changing our energy. So we're getting rid of a lot of fatigue and stress and tension. It's almost kind of coming out. So that's very common. I've seen that before. And plenty of my lectures, I see people yawning all the time or stuff like that. And that's very common. We're just shifting our brain chemistry. So it's very common for people to feel kind of tired. But the key is once you catch yourself being tired, it's to try to reel yourself back to the middle. You know, mindfulness is all about that kind of middle ground, that balance between relaxation and intention and focus. So it's a discipline. It's a practice. But, you know, I'm glad you're able to share. Yeah, yeah. Anyone else?
And I feel like when I put my hands, like some kind of energy between the hands.
Oh, you felt something. Okay, cool. That's wonderful. Yeah. Did anyone else maybe feel something in your palms or some kind of heaviness? Yeah? Yeah. Good. Anyone else feel something? Yeah.
It felt to me like a magnetic pull. Like when I was trying to pull
good.
It apart, they wanted to go back together.
Yeah, yeah. You know, this is just connecting to your own flow and your own rhythm. You know, so much of our lives are just processed from over here, right? You just think and, you know, we're connecting over here. So through mindfulness meditation, you really are able to connect to a lot of your greater senses and connecting to your body, and so that we're not just here, but we're, you know, here, we're connecting to our vehicle. It's ever more stronger and solid and supportive. You know, if you ever look at a car, some cars have, if you look at a car, the way that I kind of look at stress and anxiety, it's almost as if you're driving with bricks at the back of it, right? And they're just kind of dragging and dragging you down. Mindfulness meditation allows you to take some of those bricks that are holding you back from, you know, going like a sports car, going really fast, and, you know, allowing yourself to just, you know, go through life and navigate. You know, so that's wonderful. Anyone else feel anything within your body or within the practice?
Yeah. Yeah. To your point, my back hurts right now, and in the beginning I felt like I just focused on the pain, and then as you were going through different parts of your body, I felt myself relaxed. And I feel like I focused on other parts that didn't hurt.
How do you think you were able to redirect your focus? Because I know, I'm sure plenty of people have had that. How did you get to that point?
I just tried to keep my eyes closed the whole time, and I just listened to your voice.
Very good. Okay, a lot of cool experiences. Yeah. Yeah.
I was tired before I came from running around today, and now I'm so relaxed, I just want to take a nap.
Okay, cool. So we have both ends of the spectrum. You know, the thing is, you know...
Can you repeat here? Have the microphone.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can you just repeat what you said so others can hear?
Oh, it was a joke. I can't say it. It's okay. No, I was tired before I came, and now I'm so relaxed, I want to take a nap.
Yeah, so it hits everyone kind of differently. You know, everyone comes here with their own stuff and their own personalities, their own energy. So, you know, meditation works, you know, it'll hit you at different parts, and everyone has different circadian rhythms and stuff like that. So it you know, works with everyone differently. From my experience in my practice, you know, optimally the best time to do it is kind of when you begin your day. Ideally, you want to do this all the time. We always want to be aware of ourselves and our bodies and how we're looking at things and being able to be in that observer mode. But, you know, through, you know, the practical practice of it, you know, to me, the morning is most important. That's your base of your day, and you're clear from sleeping, right? You're just in those great alpha waves, and you're just waking up, and you're just processing. And before you go to bed, you know, that's great, too, because it allows you to just let everything kind of go so that you're able to get into deeper sleep states and go into, you know, better restful states. But, you know, meditation, you know, has proven to be almost as powerful as taking a nap, you know, because it really allows people to recharge and reconnect. So, you know, that's a definite possibility for you to feel recharged from it. Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people call it the power nap, the waking power nap, the aware power nap, right? So, yeah, okay. I have room for one more point, and then I'd like to get a little bit more, a couple more things. Yeah. Yes?
I feel like the blood circulation in my forehead has increased.
You feel like the blood flow has increased? Yeah, you know, sure. So she said that she feels the blood flow in her forehead has increased. Absolutely. I mean, stress could really allow in a lot of bodily tension. So we're not able to feel as much of our flow and our own rhythm. So, you know, it really could allow you to connect to your own flow and just allow your body to just, you know, process and just experience and just allow things to happen. I mean, so much of us get in our own way of that. But that's wonderful. Okay? So, you know, at the end we'll have a couple more times for questions or thoughts and stuff like that. You know, who here has heard of emotional freedom technique? Has anyone ever heard of that? EFT? You have? Yeah. So, a lot of, you know, this last, you know, kind of section focuses on, and you had a great segue to this, you know, the body holds a lot of tension. You know, there's euphemisms within the English language. A lot of people say, I'm holding a lot on my shoulders, I have the world, I just have to get this off my chest, right? I have, you know, butterflies in my stomach. So, you know, the body really tells us a lot about what's going on, and euphemisms are there to really get us a better understanding of how we operate. So, you know, a lot of what EFT, emotional freedom technique does is allow people to get into the deeper mind-body connection, and that great, you know, biofeedback technique and mechanisms that we could use allow us to, you know, get into those kind of cells and just allow the cells to just, you know, open and for you to connect and expand. So, you know, what you're going to do is just, if you're comfortable with it, has anyone felt a part of their body that was kind of tight or tense while you were meditating or stuff like that? Yes? So what you could do essentially is just, you could do it within opening your eyes or closing your eyes, but you could focus on one part of your body and you could just simply gently just tap. And this creates a stronger mind-body connection towards that area. Because like I said, we're usually from here. So this allows us to tune our guitars a lot better and tune into what strings are kind of out of whack, right? So, you know, if you could just simply just close your eyes or keep them open, just simply just gently tap that area. And just breathing in and breathing out, and that's it. And this can help, you know, blood flow and your own ability to understand where you're holding stress and how it occurs. And through understanding your patterns, you're able to change. We can't change if we don't connect, right? So just simply connecting to that area. And you could even make a noise while you're doing this, like a type sound. And like I mentioned before, sound has great, you know, abilities to help us out. So when I do this, I, you know, connect to my voice and it helps me. So you could gently make like an ah sound while you're doing this. And just for 2 minutes, give yourself this time. So whatever you're comfortable with, it could be to yourself or out loud, but just connecting. Very good. Breathing in and breathing out, just connecting to that area. Allowing your mind-body connection to be stronger and just focusing on that area. Asking that area what it is that it's kind of holding and how can we let this go? What needs to be out of this area? Very good. Just allowing yourself to focus on this area. Allowing yourself to feel rhythm or connection to this point. Very good. Very good. Very good. Just connecting and allowing yourself to just experience this area, just breathing in. Exhale, breathe out through your mouth, very good. And try to keep your head almost level, right? Because a lot of anxiety happens from the head up, and if we keep our head level or lower, we really are able to bring it downwards and get a lot more grounded. That's it. It's not punished yet. Very good. 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 And slowly, you're just going to take your palms and focus on another area. You can take your open palms and just gently just tap or your fingertips, whatever you can feel comfortable with. Send yourself positive messages to those areas and just focusing on what you're holding on to, you know, why is that area tight, and just allowing your body to just heal by itself. It knows what to do, right? It knows what to do, but we get in the way of its own rhythm. You know, think of that forest analogy with the flow of the rivers and the trees and the wind. You know, your body knows what to do. So by simply just letting go, you're able to allow your body to just be a natural organism, right? Ecosystem. Very good. Breathing in And exhale, breathe out. Very good. Last minute, breathe in. And exhale, breathe out. And slowly, three times is always a charm. So you're going to pick another spot of your body that may feel tight, may feel tense. It could be the top of your head, wherever that may be. And just tapping it and just allowing yourself to just let it go and getting into your own rhythm. And that's it. Flow. Wherever that may be. It may be your shoulders, maybe your back. And just simply connecting to that point. Very good. Allowing yourself to be in greater rhythm and greater flow. That's it. Focusing. Very focused. And relaxed, too. Very good. Last 30 seconds. Very good. You can tap your forehead, wherever you like to be. Be creative. The paintbrush is in your own hands. This is your own body. This is your own dance. Good. Very good. Breathing in. Breathing out. Very good. Slowly just drop your arms and just gently just shake your head gently side to side. Very good. And you could even go up and down. If you're able to, you could go around, or if you're more comfortable, go side to side. Meet yourself where you are. Honor where you are. Honor your condition. That's it. So side to side, up and down. Very good. Okay. Okay, and slowly just take your palms and rub them very quickly. Good. Connect to that heat. Okay. When we feel tense, we feel very oftentimes very cold, right? So through heat, we're able to really heat up our own freezer that stress and anxiety could create, right? So we feel a lot warmer, a lot more peaceful, a lot colder, more whole. And just focus on one area. Just last time, just put your hands in the one area, wherever that may be. And last minute, breathing in. And exhale, breathe out. Breathing in. And exhale, breathe out. Very good. Allow yourself to go deeper and deeper and deeper into your own instrument and honoring it and seeing it as an ally and something that has gotten you so far in life and is here to support and just connecting to your own natural body. That's it. Breathing in. And exhale, breathe out. Very good. Just slowly let your arms go. One last time, and just looking at the ground, taking just three deep breaths. Your eyes could be open or closed, just breathing in. And exhale, breathe out through your mouth. You can even create a ha sound. That's good. You may yawn, you may feel tension. You may feel released, you may feel tired. Whatever it is, just accept your condition. Honor it, accept it, embrace it. That's it. Very good. And slowly, and opening up our eyes. Okay. And this is the last part of the section. Is just we're going to focus on an area in the room for about 1 or 2 minutes. I'm not going to say one word. Maybe a good thing, but you're just going to focus on one or two things in the room. And like I said before, the goal of, well, mindfulness doesn't really have goals, but an aspect of mindfulness is really to connect to your body, connect to yourself, and formulate a greater connection to the outer world, right? So that you're more in tune with your environment, with what's going around you, so that ultimately you could feel a lot more altruistic, right? So once we are able to really calm down our bodies and our breaths and feel more connected, we're able to see the world through a greater prism, a greater lens. So what we're going to do now is focusing our mindful, you know, skills towards the outer world. So you could focus on the back of a chair, the rug, but for the last 2 minutes, we're just going to put our attention there. And if you do feel comfortable, maybe you could try to sit up straight and maybe have an open chest, because open chests are always good. It allows the energy to flow, and it has a nice balance of relaxation and confidence. It's really good, and when people kind of walk like this, they're holding a lot, right? So just try your best to sit up straight. And what you're just going to do is just focus on one particular aspect in the room, and just for yourself, give yourself these 2 minutes just to focus. relax your eyes and just bring yourself back to yourselves, normal eyes, body, just back to now. Very good. Very good. Okay. And just for the last 2 minutes, if this is possible, we're just going to just try to smile as much as we can. And just, you could laugh if you want, but just for 1 or 2 minutes, just try to smile. Okay. And that may find some changes. Okay. A lot less muscles to smile than to frown, right? So just simply just smile and, you know, think of this moment in this room, and connection to yourself and all these lovely people here around you today who are so grateful and thankful for being in this space, in this room. And, you know, think of other aspects in your life that you're grateful and thankful for. You know, do your best to show those whites. It's, you know, training your mind, it's a discipline. Look at our bodies, but what about our emotions? What about our ways of handling life? This is an opportunity to train, to strengthen, to reshape. Very good. Just smiling. Last minute, okay? I'll do it too. You could laugh too. That's okay. That's okay. Okay, and just unwind. Hopefully you're not sore tomorrow. Okay. All right. Very good. Okay? So, I'm going to open up the floor for however more questions that we may have within this room, and we'll go from there, okay? Does anyone have any other, you know, questions that have been on their minds, or anything about mindfulness, or how you can implement this in your day-to-day life, or how you can maybe teach it to those around you, not just practice it? Anyone, questions or anything like that? Yes. She has a microphone for you.
You keep using the term mindfulness, and then at the beginning you mentioned Reiki and hypnotherapy and these other terms, and I'm just trying to understand, so if we wanted to read more about it, or, I mean, does mindfulness fall into one of these categories more than another, or
Yeah.
Could you just explain the connection?
Yeah, no, when I was very young and studying, I would hear all these terms such as hypnosis, Reiki, mindfulness, and I asked my teacher, what's the difference? Because when I'm doing hypnosis, it seems kind of similar to mindfulness. But what I could say is, you know, hypnosis, you know, is, you know, purposeful towards change. It's geared towards an aspect of your life that you're trying to change. You're trying to go somewhere. You're trying to adjust. Now, Reiki is, you know, started by Dr. Makao Usui in Japan. It's different symbols and different hand motions and, you know, understanding energy and stuff like that. So that's a little bit different. You know, mindfulness really asks you nothing more than just to let go and connect to yourself, your breathing. And it's not necessarily just a meditation. You know, it's something that we do 24/7. You know, allows you to be in that observational mode versus reactive to what, you know, life throws your way. So it's terrific for New York. Really, I would say it's like the greatest thing that New York's ever had. No, but it, you know, the Buddha had his own enlightenment, and then Zen practice came kind of after. So mindfulness kind of falls under that Zen practice. But a lot of society likes to kind of label in a group, and, you know, I understand where they're coming from, because for people, it's like you want to, you know, have a mindfulness workshop. It better be geared towards that, because we want to know what we're getting into. That's what keeps us safe. That's what keeps us comfortable. But you could have all these experiences, just as you had here within, you know, Reiki or hypnosis or anything like that. You know, but mindfulness, you know, is geared towards, you know, being present, and being whole, and, you know, taking a step back and observing. Does that make sense?
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So I used to have those same questions.
Yeah. Okay.
You know. Yeah.
Well, this reminded me of Tai Chi and yoga in a way. I mean, all of this is implemented in both, except there is more movement.
So, yeah, she said that it reminded her a bit of Tai Chi and yoga. Sure, all these groups are using all these techniques, and what the important aspect of it is, allows you to, you know, really be present, to slow down your brain, connect to the now, and there's different styles and ways to go about it, you know, but its goal is kind of the same.
How would you suggest us doing this every day if we don't take you home with us to walk us through?
Well, That's a nice question. Well, you could technically take me home because we have this recorder on the Facebook group page. So this is there, am I right? Right? So this is a 24/7 hour access to you. But, you know, with mindfulness, you know, the aspect of it is that it's very empowering. We're not trying to, you know, formulate a guru dynamic with myself or Dr. John Kabat-Zinn or any of these big name people in the field. You know, the strength of the mindfulness is a connection to yourself, right? And seeing yourself as a great strength and, you know, the great teacher and the great enlightened one. So it's really to cultivate your own practice. You know, I could tell you and teach you everything to do, but if you guys were to be practicing everything that we did today and just be doing that, I'm not happy because that's my practice, right? And that was me. The mindfulness practice is supposed to be everyone's. It's supposed to be yours. And that's what creates it to be your own. And if there's aspects of my practice that you could implement in your daily regimen, then awesome. But it's ultimately about owning and, you know, creating what, you know, senses right within yourself. You know, there's so many different avenues to do. So it's really what's making sense. Some people, you know, go on a treadmill. Some people do kickboxing. Some people do this. So it's finding your own style, your own pattern that really works with you and your own schedule. You know, it's not a cookie cutter, right? It's very flexible. But yeah, you know, I'm so thankful this is going on Facebook Live, and you could look at this whenever you want. You know, such a great idea. Thank God for the internet, really. I'm so thankful because, you know, that really helps. Thank you. Yeah.
Just also be up on our YouTube page, and that might be easier for more people to access.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to know, is there any age limit for this? If you're older, is it harder when you're older to learn this?
So she asked a wonderful question. I like that. I really like that question. She asked if it was older to learn this. The key to mindfulness is openness. You know, it's much like with my hypnosis clients. If you kind of want it and you're able to, you know, work on letting go and stuff like that, then you can get it. Whatever you resist persists. So if you don't want it, if you want to be skeptical about it, then that's okay. That's fine. That's where you're going to be. You know, but if you want this to make this a practice and you want to, you know, maybe find something that may adjust your ability to, you know, go deeper and be stronger and, you know, handle life's emotions from a different vantage point, you know, mindfulness may be for you, you know, so age doesn't have a limit, you know, and, you know, Judaism, you know, one of, you know, the greatest, you know, rabbis of all time didn't start learning the alphabet until his, like, mid-80s, and then he became a teacher. So I always say age is what you make of it. It's that simple. It's, you know, we all have our own canvases, and, you know, but mindfulness allows us to really defy age, to look at age and time from a new perspective, that every moment is new and whole, and get us off that, you know, that rat wheel and that cycle. So, you know, that's a change that could happen. As long as you see it as new and whole and, you know, get off of that pattern, you're able to shift, yeah. You know, every day is new. Yeah.
I have a similar question, but on the other end of the spectrum. I have a similar question, but on the other end, I was thinking this would be a great thing for my daughter. She's 12, but is there a good way to incorporate it into child's life?
I always say meet the client. So I'm sorry. So she asked if there is a good way to incorporate this for a child, you know, for someone who's 12, for your daughter. As a social worker, the greatest principle that I've learned is meet the person where they're at. You know, so what works for you may not work with her. So being more mindful allows you to tune into her and what will work with her. And your awareness will be there. So I think from that awareness, you'll be able to kind of cultivate and tune in. You don't have to necessarily be someone who's been practicing this for years to kind of know what works. You could just go by, you know, what works. And usually with kids, you know, kids are going very fast. You know, there's been a diagnosis that's been thrown out there every second. So I know, I think meeting kids where they're at, you know, from an active, you know, standpoint and trying it piece by piece, and also being open-ended with it. We're saying, hey, you know, this is something cool. This has worked for me. This may help you. You may try it. Who knows? Maybe it could also be collaboratively where it could strengthen a stronger bond between you and your 12-year-old to practice. You know, so there's so many different ways to go about it. But there's no clear answer that I can provide. But other than meeting meeting her daughter where she's at, really, you know. So usually active works with, from my, you know, I worked in a program in Sedona, Arizona with, it was kind of like a mindfulness-based program for students from Korea. And they just got off the plane and they were getting adjusted to the American culture. And a lot of mindful techniques that we use with these kids was just simply playing basketball. But playing basketball, but being aware of how you interact with other people and how you were on the court and stuff like that. So mindfulness isn't just restricted to meditation or sitting in a position. It's a practice that we can implement in every moment in every life, just being aware of ourselves and how we handle life's forces and what we put out. Yeah. Yeah.
Is mindfulness only for ourselves, or is it also being aware of what is around us too?
Mm.
Because I think that's a very, as a social person, it's important to know the people around you and to be able to connect with them too.
So she asked if mindfulness is just kind of like the self-centered practice that we do just to connect to ourselves and stuff like that, and not for something that's for the outside world. It's very hard. Have you ever found that when you have are talking with someone, but there's so much on your mind, you just can't listen. You just have to just blurt out whatever's in your mind or what's going on within you. That may have happened. Yeah.
If I'm talking to myself, yeah, that's
with
it.
A lot of the chatter that goes on.
I'm a teacher, so that might be, I'm looking at things differently.
Oh. Yeah.
So I'm always very conscientious about the people around me.
Super.
And to try to understand where they're coming from when they say things.
Wow.
So,
we need,
that's part of mindfulness, I thought.
We need more of you around.
I'll clone myself as soon as it's possible.
Thank you. Thank you. But, you're a wonderful example, and thank you for sharing that. I wish we'd have more of that around, so thank you. But, you know, mindfulness just isn't this, you know, self-centered practice where you just kind of do and just try to tune your whole world out from you. No. Part of being a relaxed person is when you're relaxed, you really are able to tune into the world around you. And plenty of people talk about enlightenment and stuff like that. You know, enlightenment isn't just kind of self-serving. It's, you know, awareness. And there's many different levels of it. You know, so the, you know, mindfulness, there's an aspect of it, as I mentioned before, which at the end, it's to create, you know, feelings of love, of empathy, and ultimately to have an altruistic state where you're connected to the world around you. And I think plenty of times suffering comes from being boxed in and just being hyper-focused on what's, you know, in you, and that's understandable. So this really allows you to connect while also, you know, connect to the world around you, and that's the goal. So connecting to within, connecting to without, you know, to the outer world, right? You can't do one without the other, yeah. It's hard to. Yeah.
So what do you do?
Can you speak just a second?
Yeah.
When you have someone who is like the polar opposite, say you're doing well with relaxing and being more mindful and sensitive, I suppose, and then, but you, okay, so my husband was driving me crazy last night. He's very analytical and very much wants to put things in order or whatever.
Okay.
And I'm working so hard to try to like just not have that affect me. It's difficult because you go back and forth between that selfishness thing, or I want to be empathetic to him and say, well, I know he's having trouble with that. Mm. I know he's having trouble getting in tune with his own feelings, that he feels the need to put them in order like that.
Mm.
Do
you do when you, you know, if I find it hard to keep
the peace at that point in myself, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So she asked, how do you, and you could correct me if I'm a little bit off base, how do you keep peace with, you know, sometimes life throws you a certain personalities or a lot of stuff? How can you keep that strong grounding? You know, as I was mentioning before, my great teacher, the archetype of the Chicago Bulls and Los Angeles Lakers, Phil Jackson, he was the coach who won 11 championships. He once had a basketball player on his team by the name of Dennis Rodman. And I don't know if you ever heard of Dennis Rodman. But Dennis Rodman was a man who has went through, you name it, before becoming a basketball player. He grew about a foot in 1 year, and that was his greatest gift, you know, and that got him, you know, into the NBA in many ways. But Dennis, you know, no coach knew how to handle Dennis. And Phil came in, and basically he just allowed Dennis to do his thing. And he said, okay, now, you know, when Dennis would color his hair, he would do all these on-the-court, off-the-court tactics and stuff like that. And then he said, now that you have done this, are you ready to speak almost? So it's almost as if that wild bronco analogy where you let the bronco kind of do their thing. And mindfulness allows you to take that pause and that back seat and allow people to process. A lot of times, you know, through hyper-analyzing, we want people to be like us, and we just try to process, and it comes from our own filter. But when we're aware of another person, we're able to accept and get out of our own filters and just allow a flow of that person to kind of go. And, you know, people have their own rhythms and stuff like that. And, of course, there's conversations. But my greatest recommendation is allowing people to be kind of who they are. And once they express that, it's like, okay, now what? When can we talk once you have expressed that part of you? And, you know, Dennis was very successful under Phil because he allowed him to be himself. So, you know, some people need that. They have that fire that they just need to release. But it also takes control away from that person. You know, it's saying that that person has their own thing and I don't have much control over them. You know, I just observe, I take a back seat, and I allow them to come. It's much like that same paradigm, the same flow with any aspect in life. You're going to have something that comes to you. That's not personal. What we make of it is personal. That's our own canvas, right? So that's our job. We can't control certain aspects in society or certain people. We can't control is our own stimuli response dynamic. And the greater the gap of that is, you know, the more peace we'll have. And it doesn't mean that we're walking around totally peacefully all day, but, you know, that creates a lot of empowerment and it takes a lot of control away from other people, significant partners within our life, right? Make sense? Okay.
I have a question.
Wait,
hold on.
We had a tie.
I just wanted to ask you, as it relates to breast cancer and the anxiety that goes with that. Mm. I find that I thought I was a calm and cool and, you know, but since this diagnosis of breast cancer and other things that have happened, I would like to be able to utilize some of these breathing when I get really super anxious, because I'm pretty sure everybody here who has had breast cancer can identify with those kinds of feelings when you really feel a little overwhelmed by anxiety, even though you've tried your best to be calm and to, you know, face it and to move on and all of that that's going on. So I want to get from you some techniques when those feelings of anxiety come upon us, what kind of breathing techniques probably would be able to help us when it comes to that kind of thing?
Sure. Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing with the group. That, you know, it's really helpful. You know, I'm someone who could, you know, certainly sympathize and empathize with, but I can never understand cancer. So, but for me, what I found is what you just said was very mindful. You were able to tune into your own patterns, you know, through your own anxiety of your own situation. And that's being a very mindful individual. You know, from that, you know, you recognize that, you know, anxiety, you know, may be there. You know, the question is do I want to associate myself with all these thoughts that are occurring? You know, because the mind is going to go. You know, that's just human nature. The question is do I want to be there or do I want to erase and replace and redirect my focus? You know, and a lot of anxiety comes from, as I said, from focused on the unknown or the future or stuff like that. So mindfulness is great, you know, for this, you know, area because it allows you to just, you know, accept and be present. And you already are an incredibly mindful individual that you're able to tune in and, you know, catch your patterns. And I think a lot of it is just accepting that, you know, anxiety may be there. You know, the question is do I want to be a part of it? You know, is my one of my greatest teachers, Marsha Linehan, in dialectical behavioral therapy, talks about, she implements a lot of mindfulness aspects in her, you know, DBT work, and she says the only way to get out of quicksand is to first recognize that you're in it. So I think that that's, you know, right now you've recognized what you're in it, and I think that fight or that struggle is tough. Sometimes we just, you know, acceptance is, you know, very helpful. Make sense?
Yeah.
Do you think that the techniques that you taught earlier are useful with the anxiety? Are those something they could put in their toolbox for when they're feeling anxious about, specifically about, you know, the breast cancer and the things that come along with that?
Absolutely, yeah. So she asked if the techniques that I use could be translatable or helpful towards you know conditions that are, you know, whatever, you know, what you have. What I have to say is, of course, you know, mindfulness is something for everybody, you know, and part of the goal of mindfulness is to really allow you to see yourself as, you know, part of a greater whole, that altruistic sake. I think at times when, you know, you do have a diagnosis that may be, you know, isolating, right? So mindfulness really allows you to connect to yourself and your body and the world around you. And the techniques that I do could really, you know, change and shift and help, you know, any aspect of your day. You know, but it's about creating for yourself what's a helpful practice. And that goes by trial and error and scheduling and whatever works best for you, but it's owning a practice. So these techniques can certainly be used and implemented at any, you know, given day and time for anything. So yes, absolutely.
So for example, if a woman or man knows that he has a test coming up, a CAT scan or a PET scan coming up, and the anxiety that surrounds that, you know, can interfere with sleeping for the week before, if you're anxious about it, recognizing that and maybe deciding, okay, I'm going to be proactive, I'm going to do my exercises, that could help to manage that anxiety, given, you know, you're recognizing that you face that every time you go for one of these tests. Or is it that you have to practice this all the time to benefit from it and be proactive on a regular basis?
Yeah. Well, so she asked if this is, you know, something that could benefit test taking. Do we have to do it all the time? You know, or, you know, is this just seldomly here and there? You know, what I have to say is, you know, we stretch before we go on a treadmill and we work out our muscles, right? So before, you know, stressful situations, you know, we could, you know, stress our own emotional regulations through mindfulness, and that could be helpful. That could get us into a better state to really, you know, handle our life's challenges in that day. It's almost as if as you're going out to, you know, sail and you've got a very solid ship and stuff like that. Or I always use the tree analogy. You know, mindfulness really could allow you to be that strong-rooted tree, you know, amongst the wind that comes at you, and sometimes you know, fall back, but you get back up there, and that's from your own awareness and getting yourself back up to now. You know, but mindfulness is something you could do not just sitting in a Tibetan monastery. It could be something that you do all the time, just simply tuning in and recognizing your patterns and your ways of viewing life and just allowing things to let go and just simply just slowing down, you know, creating an own deeper sense of self-awareness and connection. It's that same, you know, analogy that I made to that guitar player and that guitar. You know, that's with our bodies, with ourselves, with our emotion, and mindfulness can definitely open that up. It's possible. Yeah.
That's one. My question is connected with her question and the other lady question. Next month, I'm gonna have another mammogram after a year and a half being diagnosed with breast cancer. I know I'm going to have anxiety the week before, even now I'm still thinking. Can I use what you teach us tonight, start from now to that day, or continue using, or how I can be prepared to the day before my next tomography? Mm-hmm.
So she asked in prior sent, you know, and so she asked before her mammogram exam if this is something that may be helpful, if that's something that she can use. You know, absolutely. I think, you know, we're used to people giving us licensure to do things in life and stuff like that, but, you know, it's cultivating your own practice. So if you practice this in the room today and it's helpful, then who's there to stop you from doing it, you know, beforehand? You know, it certainly could be helpful. I know from hypnosis, actually, I do what's called, I know plenty of people do hypnobirthing, which some people don't like the drugs that go in, so they're able to go under hypnosis and give birth. So, you know, mindfulness could definitely get you a lot stronger and have a greater sense of self-efficacy within your own self and your own life's, you know, journey. And just connecting to this moment, you know, allows you to feel peace and whole and, you know, forming mastery of that one moment forms a mastery of life and its greater tapestry. So, you know, it's just being present, being with yourself, and using a lot of ego support, which is positive self-talk and stuff like that. If you get into negative dialogue, we can switch it to positive. So, yeah.
And let me just say that I know that when we do this, and sometimes we do this in the support groups where, you know, it's a group of women who come together who have diagnosis, and this is when people have a lot of anxieties when their next test comes up. And we do meditation, and a lot of women have said that being mindful and practicing meditation and whatever that looks like for you has helped them, and it's lowered their blood pressure, made them be able to go into the test in a different way than they were before. So, you know, being able to use what we learned today has absolutely been helpful for women who I've spoken to. Anytime. So I think probably that's why all of the social worker hands went.
And even sitting, waiting for your test, you know, sitting there,
just doing some deep breathing can be helpful, if you haven't meditated up until that day. Just sitting there and closing your eyes while you're waiting. You're in your gown. You're waiting for the nurse to put during the exam. Sometimes when women are receiving chemo, they get very anxious about having, you know, an infusion, and they're really shaking. And we do breathing right in the chemo chair, and it's amazing how, you know, it helps. And they've never done it before. You know, we just say, take some deep breaths, in and out, concentrate on your breathing. And it really does help.
Yeah. I think we're kind of like a physical society where someone goes to a gym and they're lifting weights. It's like we see that as, wow. You know, so mindfulness is an inner gym. It's going to your inner gym and just sharpening the mind and its ability to regulate its own emotions and ways of handling things. So it's really an inner workout, you know, that you do. That's my closest analogy, yeah.
When I had to get an MRI biopsy, I knew I was going to have to be in that tube for such a long time, and I just visualized, I'm a music editor for film, so I visualized winning an Emmy Award. So I totally visualized the dress that I wore and getting it, and it was like I took that time as just having a positive visualization, so I wasn't even where I was.
Visualization is great, and I always say where the mind goes, you know, the body and emotions follow. So it's our greatest ally if we know how to work with it, and mindfulness really allows you to become a friend with it and tune into it and, you know, get it to be an ally versus an enemy, as so many struggle with in life.
I have another question. I wasn't here at the beginning, so I don't know if you mentioned this, but is it good to use a mantra with this type of mindfulness?
There's a lot of questions or people asking me if it's good to do this. And what I say, if it works, then do it. You know, it's that simple. But from my practice, mantras are wonderful. They really allow you to get out of that monkey mind and a lot more relaxed. And, you know, it's great. You know, people, it works with, you know, some people the treadmill works, other people the elliptical. You know, mantras work for many.
So would you suggest how you would, for yourself, what kind of mantra should you choose? I know OM, but...
That's an incredibly powerful mantra.
Yeah.
OM. Oh, yeah. That's very powerful. It could just simply be a sound that you make. You know, because from my experience, plenty of people believe that the voice, you know, radiates from the vocal cords. But from tuning in, you could actually feel it, you know, from the belly. You know, so the, you know, that's why you say, you know, I'm talking from my gut here, right? So, you know, you could just make simple like sounds or stuff like that, and whatever works for you, just kind of do it. Some people say do 103, 106. It's what works. Yeah.
I have another question. When you were saying touch a part of your body that you want to relax it, I have scoliosis and I have a lot of back pain in my lower back. I can't reach it. So is it possible to let someone else touch that spot for you, or you have to be the one?
Oh, absolutely. Sure. I have a lot of friends and myself who's, you know, Reiki practitioners. We do that same kind of stuff. So, of course, people can do it for you. Just as healing, just as powerful. And it's, you know, a nice, you know, collaborative dynamic that you can have. So, of course, yeah. Yeah. Never push yourself past your limitations. Always, you know, do what you're comfortable with. You know, I really recommend.
Thank you.
Thank you. I was just going to say something related to the anxiety and related to music. I remember I was going through a hard time, and I had gone to Reiki, and I was going somewhere regularly, and it was at 7 p.m. on a Friday. Perfect, because I would leave, and I would be so relaxed that I would fall asleep. it was great. But when I was there, the instructor suggested just going on YouTube, and you could find meditation music. Specifically, I had trouble with my stress and sleep, so I would have really bad insomnia. So I know on YouTube you can just Google meditation music and sleep, and you can get really like soft music. I remember there was one that I found that was an hour. It was perfect because I would focus on that and kind of meditate right before I would go to bed, and then I would fall asleep. And it really helped kind of clear my head. And whatever you do, whatever you think about, is up to you. But that really helped me. So if it's before a test or anything in general, that really helped me, and it was really good.
It was even apps.
Yeah, apps.
Absolutely, yeah, music is wonderful. There's actually a song on YouTube, I love it. It's called Merlin's Magic. If you get a second or two, you can just type it on YouTube. It's called Merlin's Magic. Very, very, very calming. That from my clients that have come into my practice, I really use that a lot, and it works every time. It's called The Heart of Reiki or Merlin's Magic. Very, you know, out there, but it's wonderful. If you have any other interested artists that you may be interested in, I have a couple of referrals too. For good, you know, kind of new age meditation artists. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I just want to say quickly that somebody gave me a mantra recently that was extremely helpful to me. I just want to share it with you, and, you know, it's something to take with you. She said to say your name and then to say let go. And what you're doing is you're letting all of the negative that's inside of you out, and all of the stress and all of the tension out, and you're directing it at yourself by saying your own name, and you're validating yourself. For me, it's very helpful. It's helpful in combination with the breathing techniques, but somehow, making it directed specifically at me was very, very helpful. It's short, sweet, and goes. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing.
You're welcome.
Wow. Learning a lot today. I got to try that.
Yeah.
Well, let's give Jacob a big round of applause.
Thank you.
I have to say, this I think is the only forum I've been at in 3 years where we had 2 minutes of complete silence. So I think that's if you could make sure that you fill out the evaluation and just give them to one of the staff on the way out, we would appreciate it. And if you're not already on our mailing list, make sure you have that information. Some other great forms coming up.